It takes brains and brawn to be an elite female hockey player in Canada. These are the women of the new Canadian Women's Hockey League. USCHO Game of the Week is the first ever national internet broadcast for women's college hockey. It is also individually funded. That's why the Game of the Week needs your support to maintain and expand its coverage. For more information on how to contribute, please call 212-933-0652 or send an email to uschobroadcast@yahoo.com. That's 212-933-0652 or uschobroadcast@yahoo.com.
For the first time ever, the USCHO Game of the Week will go north of the border, and we're very proud to have our first ever broadcast of the inaugural season of the Canadian Women's Hockey League as part of our package, and the debut for tonight on this December evening, what is a crisp but clear Saturday in Toronto, Canada. The Burlington Barracudas, 7-5 fourth place in the Central Division, up against the defending champs, Brampton, Canada Thunder, 9-3-1 on the campaign. In the friendly confines of their home ice facility, the Power League Center, also home to the Brampton Battalions of the entire hockey league. And this should be a very fun night of hockey here on the USCHO Game of the Week. I think for those of you who've been with us for the past four seasons, the 100 games plus that we've done, this will be in many ways a reintroduction of players you know and love. It will also be an introduction of maybe some of the best players in the history of the game that you've heard of. And we are very excited as this is the first of eight broadcasts we have scheduled with the Canadian Women's Hockey League here in the 2007-2018 campaign, our fourth season of the year at the USCHO Game of the Week. I'm Brian Cook, as always. Of course, as we mentioned, if you've been with us since inception, give a little background on how this got started. We started, of course, with the NCAA ranks in the 2004-2005 season. And it's the NCAA, and I was part of that huge Disney, one of the best players in the world, when they don't need a place to play, whether it's a team that can see at the international level with the national team and beyond, or just looking to play for the love of the game at a high level. This is the place to do it. And so tonight, a lot of familiar names, a lot of names that we've heard of in college settings, a lot of names we've heard of in international events. In any ways, this is an all-star game for fans of women's hockey. So this should be a very fun night. Let's try to go through the two teams and introduce you to some of the key participants you will be running into. First, for the host Thunder, it really is a decorated class of players that play for the Comrade Center. The in goal, Mandy Coyne, first ever player signed by the University of Maine, graduated in 2002. Former Minnesota Duluth captain, Kristen McArthur. Sue McCutcheon of the University of Toronto. Larry Lockwood from Queen's University. Our good friend Molly Enstrom from Wisconsin. Of course, you know Molly was a guest on this show. She's also played a couple of games for me in the past. Julian Hicks, of course, a regular interviewee of the Game of the Week and ECAC player of the year last year at Cardiff. Bobby Gross Lucian, two-time All-American defenseman at Wisconsin. Lori Dupree, two-time Olympian with Team Canada. Kathy Henry from Mohawk College. Katie Hefner, one of the greatest players of all time. And the Annals of Team Canada. Tiffany Hay, our good friend, who's just in the program a couple of weeks ago, graduated from Brampton College. She is in the lab tonight as well. Kathleen Cox, a tennis player at Brown University, a captain in 2001, a U.S. Olympian in 2006. Allison Fox at Wolf University, an inaugural member of the Brampton Thunder. Meredith Ostander, also at Brown University, graduated in 2002. Cindy Eady, who's actually probably better known for her exploits on the softball field, and she was a member of Canada's Olympic softball team in 2004, and the veteran of that, Ruby Sotomayor, the captain, a member of Team Canada since 1990, played at Northeastern in the late 1980s, so we'll hear from Vicky later this evening. That is the bulk of the roster for the Brampton Thunder. On the flip side, for the Burlington Barracudas. All but one of their players hailed from the NCAA ranks. Tony Fowler, All-American goaltender at Knight Agra, led them to a Frozen Four in 2002. Kelly Hart graduated from Bemidji State just a year ago as their all-time assist leader at 100 points for Kelly Stewart, graduated from St. Cloud State in 2006. Kim McCullough, who actually was part of Dartmouth's rise to power in the late 90s and early 21st century before they became perhaps better than for the F. Michael Hayes and Katie Weatherson generation. Karen McLaughlin, perhaps better known to college fans, is Karen Drew, who played at Maine in 2001 to 2004. Lindsey Vonn, the product of Niagara, gets an paperback to his attempts, placing the Kelly Hart at the Mid-East State. The great Dan Harrigan, the all-time leading scorer in the history of Ohio State University. Rosina Schiff, who was a goaltender up front as Upshaw was making the transition from Division 3 to Division 1. She was a D3 first-team All-American along the way. Legendary defenseman Becky Keller graduated around 1997, of course, a long-time member of Team Canada, part of some of the greatest teams in the history of college hockey in Providence, Rhode Island. We'll hear from Becky in the first intermission. Michelle Warrior out of Northeastern graduated in 2003. Becky Jamison of the University of Rhode Island. Amanda Ball graduated from Colgate in 2005. Was one of their top players and was played sort of found his way in the Division I ranks earlier this season. Valerie Hall was a leading scorer, a multi-leading scorer in the history of Niagara's women's hockey, helped them win a Frozen Four along with Tony Kelly in the year 2002. And then the Zamora sisters. Christy, who of course one of the great players at Brown, led them to the national finals in 2002. And then Kelly Zamora, her younger sister, who led to Wayne State and was their leading scorer in three of four seasons. So very much a reunion for those of you who are fans of college hockey. And we're sure that you can join us on this inaugural broadcast. I'm Ryan Schultz. We will have guest analysts, of course, throughout the season. The planning for this game was pretty intense, so that was one part of the broadcast that we did not go over. So we'll be stuck with me solo tonight, but that's okay. We have plenty to talk about once the two teams hit the ice. Let's give you a little background on this league and sort of how we got involved, because it is an interesting story. Of course, there has been hockey at this level in Canada for several seasons. It went under the guise of the National Women's Hockey League until last year. The owners in that league proposed taking a year off in the Eastern Division to reorganize, and the players, instead of waiting that year out and struggling for a place to play, they kind of took it upon themselves to find sponsors on their own to restart the league under this new moniker, the Canadian Women's Hockey League. A lot of the players, a lot of the franchises are still the same. There has been some mixing and matching, but you know, if you're familiar with the National Women's Hockey League, you know who the Brampton Thunder was a part of the NWHL, and you go back to the Canadette Thunder here in the CWHL. On the flip side, the Bruins and Barracudas were perhaps better known as the Oakville Ace in the National Women's Hockey League, give or take a few players. There are seven teams in all. There are two divisions, the Central, which houses four teams in the Greater Toronto Area, and three teams in the Eastern Division, two of which are based out of Montreal, one which is located in Ottawa. So seven teams in all, and they complement and form the Eastern Division of the postgraduate system for women's hockey. Of course, if you were with us last weekend, you had exposure to the Western Women's Hockey League, which is home to Calgary Overextreme, the Minnesota Whitecaps, the Edmonton Seamers, among others. They also have a fleet of half dozen teams. And so that is really the haven. That's the haven for players after they get done with college to really play at a high level. We're here with you somewhere here to talk about the value of having a league like this as players continue to play for their national team and as other players try to make their way onto the bubble for their respective national team. So it really is important and pivotal for the college game. It's pivotal and important for the women's game to have leagues like this. And so for us in the USCHO Game of the Week, this opportunity became a natural extension of the continuity that we've been searching for in women's hockey. You were with us from inception. The goal of this prize of the USCHO Game of the Week is to fill gaps in the coverage landscape for the sport of women's ice hockey. And there are still so many gaps to be filled. What you have seen over the past four seasons as we've built our college product, you've also seen schools really take it upon themselves to show initiative in covering their own teams in the U.S. That's why you have schools that subscribe to the BC Network, schools that use their own pay-per-view video streaming services. They now can take you through the bulk of their home schedule, and it really is not left to us to fill as many holes in the college game as it was when we started in 2004, 2005. But that doesn't mean the college game ends just when the graduation cap puts into the air. There is a life in women's hockey after that. And that's why this year in season 4 of Game of the League, we saw us expand our horizons. Last weekend, we started with the Western Women's League. This weekend, we begin with the Canadian Women's Hockey League. In April, we are moved to the World Championship in China as part of our expansion into the international game. These are the forms of women's hockey where there are still so many games that don't uncover, so many great athletes who pour in relative obscurity. I just read you the roster. The amount that they've accomplished, the things that they've won at both the collegiate and the international level, is really impressive. That to have them on one two device together on a weekly basis is an impressive feat. Are there wrong things? Yes. You'll hear Becky Clark with us on how they're talking about the league's evolution. And they're two good people to talk to, as they were longtime members of the NWHL. Both of them played in the NCAA system, and the NCAA was a totally different phenomenon. I encourage you to listen to them and listen to what they talk about when it comes to college hockey, because believe me, it was not an 18 NCAA tournament. It was not a 30-team field across the West and East. It was much smaller and much different. And so, you know, they've seen the growth, they continue to push for growth, and so tonight we give you what they've been doing and how they look now in their current lineups. It's right in the game of the week. I'd be lying if I said there wasn't a personal connection here. There were a number of players when I led the roster who you heard of the interview by myself on the college program. There's a number of players who you'll hear from or see over the course of this season who have been guest analysts with me. And so for all the time that they have dedicated in helping me, a lot of them, you know, Tiffany Hay a couple weeks ago, Thanksgiving weekend. What was she doing Thanksgiving night? She was sitting at the Toronto airport trying to fly off the handle to help me to call a game. So if someone like that is willing to go the extra mile to help me, then I will certainly do what I can, sending it back the other way to try to help her and bring exposure to what she's trying to do and what her friends and her teammates are trying to do up here in the Canadian Women's Hockey League. Getting into the matchup a bit, we talked about some of the players. This is very much us joining at the midway point of the season. These teams already have a dozen plus games under their belt. Mentioned Brampton 9-3-1. Burlington 7-5, second and third in the Central Division. These two teams have met a couple of times this year. Brampton has been the best of the matchups, but we're talking to both Becky Keller and Vicky Summerhire this week. They expect this to be a pretty competitive game. So you look at the players on both sides, certainly Burlington goaltender Tanya Talley, you remember her from Niagara. You look at the numbers in college, she is still that goaltender. A 2.07 goals against her career at Niagara. 93% save percentage in Niagara's best ever season in 2002 when she was a senior. 26-8-2, started every game for Margo Cage's Purple Eagles, finishing the season with 1.56 goals against 93% save percentage. Took them all the way to their only Frozen Four appearance in earning All-American honors. A longtime member of Canada under 22 team as well, and she remains the last line of defense for the Burlington Barrel Crew. But and she'll be under fire. We talked about some of the players who are going to be shooting on her on the Brampton side, and some of the best offensive talent you will find on the planet anywhere. Certainly, college fans very familiar in recent years with the likes of Jillian Ennis, a 30-goal scorer, an ACAC Player of the Year, and an All-American a year ago at Dartmouth. Tiffany Hague, as we mentioned, over 130 points in her career at Dartmouth. Jane Hammer, one of the best goal scorers ever, hands down, the one many players you want for the Buckeye stick in the game on the line. Just go back to 2002 Salt Lake. If you remember that breakaway goal with 1 second left in the second period clock, I said U.S. fans remember it was chagrin. That was Jay Hunter scoring and sealing a gold medal victory for Team Canada on that night. But it was Wisconsin defensive north of the goal who all of our fans in the league will be familiar with. Molly Enstrom, of course, had a two-time All-American, graduated in 2005. And Bobby Gosselin, also multiple times an All-American selection, and twice an NCAA champion, 2006 and 2007. Both captains, they are both on the same blue line once again. Of course, last week they had Carl McCall back on the show. So the trifecta of a great Wisconsin graduated defenseman is in attendance. And of course, we mentioned Vicky Summerhire. Such a great interview. Chatted with her for about 20, 25 minutes this week. And just let her tell her stories about college hockey as it was at Northeastern in 1989. Let her talk about the way things were with Team Canada when she first started signing out in 1989. And of course, some of the Olympic rides that she's gone into 98 and 2003. There's some great stories that we had. Becky Keller as well. On the Burlington side, she is still their most stalwart defenseman. Graduated from Brown in 1997. Was part of a Bear team that, quite frankly, was probably the best college team that did not win the equivalent of an national title. Undefeated in the regular season in 97, 28-0, led by Becky Keller herself. And of course, Katie King, who's Brown's all time leading scorer, and head coach of Boston College. Ellie Brewer, who, of course, other one of the game that leads to the top season, and of course, the great Karen Mountie. two-time U.S. Olympic team defensive end, going 28-0 upset in the ECAC semifinals by Preston and Northeastern, but a little hurt with it. Of course, the head coach of Yale and recently inducted into the Massachusetts Hall of Fame. So those are just some of the names we'll run into. And it should be a lot of familiar faces and a lot of familiar names. And we're so glad you could join us here on December 8th. This is the first of 8 games we will do with the league this year. We certainly hope it's the beginning of a longer-term relationship. We'll hear from some of our older friends. And as well as we go along the way, of course, Brampton will be part of our first 2 broadcasts, the first one tonight against Burlington, which is set to start in just a few minutes. You can see the battlefield is out there as we get into the week. And next weekend, next Saturday at 6 p.m., I guess the CWHO's answer to the Hatfields and the McCoys is the Mississauga Chiefs and the Brampton Canada will get together. Again, that will be about a 6 p.m. start here at the Powerade Center next Saturday evening. Then we'll take a week off and then come back on December 28th as Ottawa and Vaughn get together. Ottawa headlined by Dartmouth star Katie Wellington. Vaughn, of course, a number of tremendous players from Mercyhurst, including Ashley Pendleton. And also a couple of players from other colleges, not only Karen Thatcher, their score at London College, also on their roster as well. Then, January 5th, they make the trip up to Quebec, as this Burlington club will take on the Quebec Phoenix, who, among others, has won Christine before Wisconsin graduate in that. And the next day, we'll have Real 2 of Brampton and Mississauga, this time from the Eastland complex in nearby Mississauga, Ontario. But on the 26th, the Montreal Stacks Arms, led by all-world goaltender Kim Sierre, Kim St. Pierre, playing against the Brampton club on the 26th. And on the 27th, Vaughn against Mississauga. And to close it up with another game on February 2nd, on our inaugural 8-game slate in 2007 and 2008. As it will be game one tonight, the Brampton Canada Thunder, 9-3-1 in the Central Division, up against the Burlington Barracudas. As we mentioned, if you are a fan of college hockey, if you're a fan of women's hockey of any form, this is very much the night where the stars will shine and a lot of names that you grew up knowing and a lot of players that you kind of heard of and maybe haven't gotten to know will try to bring them a little bit closer to you, and it should be a very fun night of hockey. Let's take a quick commercial break. Get things started here at the Pirates Center. USCHO Game of the Week. CWHO, the inaugural broadcast coming up in just a moment.
USCHO Game of the Week is the first ever national internet broadcast for women's college hockey. It is also individually funded. That's why the Game of the Week needs your support to maintain and expand its coverage. For more information on how to contribute, please call 212-933-0652 or send an email to uschobroadcast@yahoo.com. That's 212-933-0652 or uschobroadcast@yahoo.com. It takes brains and brawn to be an elite female hockey player in Canada. These are the women of the new Canadian Women's Hockey League.
good evening to you all. This is Anthony, once in a USCHO. Do not adjust your set. This is new, this is different, and this should be a lot of fun. Our first ever broadcast involving the Canadian Women's Hockey League here on the USCHO Game of the Week. We've done about 100 games south of the border. We dived into the Western Women's League a week ago for the first time, and then tonight, something that we've been building to where all four of the inaugural season of the Canadian Women's Hockey League. So glad we could join us. Our first of eight video cast on CW8M.ca and USCHO.com. Game one tonight. The Burlington Barracudas, 7-5, third place in the second division, and the Brampton Canada Thunder, 9-3-1, last spot ahead. Let's take a look at faceoff. And Lindsay Sullivan, one of the greatest players of all time, in the faceoff circle. Opposite Lindsay Vonnegut, and the Thunder for Thunder Waves, the Thunder, tied in the home rights with our lead. And Avery Schmidt, opposite the Barracudas in the orange. And a dark blue New York Islanders type jerseys, hooked up in behind, and a total penalty from an American American. And one of the greatest goaltenders in the history of college hockey, still flying home plate here in Ontario. First down in the near side corner. Going with the fifth offensive possession, the Wisconsin All American Bunny Elstrom deals it down the way. Kicked around the far side. Sitting here, hacking it in behind the net, available as Hempel. After reaching for it now against Bellamy Hunter, who was a teammate of Penalties on that great night until he went to the 4-4 in 2002. Instant from distance, wristed toward the cage, and we got our first whistle. We can get an interference here, who is just 49 seconds into play. And it looks like it's going to go the way of the Thunder. Jaden Hempel skating slowly toward the penalty box. At the low of the 3-12-16. What a receiver tackle for this Thunder club. The 3-8-2-time Canadian Olympian, Hempel 3-time the number 3-10, and so the first 5-4 situation is Kelly Zimmerman, coming to the state, and with it, Catherine Governor. Gosh, sure, hey, look to the high step first, and the play of the game's first save will set up down. And not coincidental, we'll see Catherine come up in the center, the first hand round, a very versatile player. Jason Ford, Jason Defense, can really pretty much do anything for Digit Murphy, and skated for the U.S. National Team in 2006 winning games, and takes the first shift in the 4-9 final here. The ball will be a penalty delay. 45 seconds in the half. He's 3 in the box for another minute and 52. Kim McCullough. Going to start with Kelly. Feels like the line on that. Looking at what she has. Ricky Eckerbuck is available on the left hand side. Penalty's the ball is up there on the right. And it's the ball from the step forward. Against Meredith Ostrander. Ostrander and Pump. A couple of former Brown Bears. Here comes Cross for a hand up to Steve. Great pass to Ostrander. He's in the circles. Close to the back end. Here's his goal from the left. Kicked out for the former son. The son of Lillian Albertista runs it back down low. It's Eckerbuck who just graduated from the Indy State. Now it's back down to the other side. 118 going on low degrees now, 120 on the fourth. CWHO here in Brampton, Ontario, the Pomeroy Center, home to the Brampton Battalion of the Ontario Hockey League as well. But tonight is home to our first CWHO broadcast. And as the Thunder aggressive on the kill, glove on the head of Jaden Hempel. Legs back into the zone, now taken by Matt O'Donnell, the Colgate Flash, going with the right wing center. Team changing behind her as he scoops down behind the net. Well, the left is. Bodies are in. Scale up the near side wall. Knocked down there by Becky Killer. We're here from Becky. Between periods 1 and 2. Only action to Becky Killer. A good matchup of some of the best defensive in the world. And action features that one too. There's a rate run out on the far side of Loftus. Loftus kings it all the way down. Hasn't made it all the way to B minor. Just over 2 on the end. And a scoreless first period here on the USCHO Game of the Week. Tonight's the center. Final charge on the power play here. We're coming in transition. Lindsay Vonnegut speaking down low. Val Hall heads to the front. Step up the center. 9. Kelly didn't shoot. Deals near side of the hole. Near side is blocked. And then rotating super person. Chipped up the wall. Elston trying to lead the charge. Here comes Molly Elston combo through the center. Left wing side, Sunhorn. Elston drives the rush. Sunhorn is long distance off. Kind of the side of the left leg. A wrap to find the center. 2:45 on the score in the first period. Up in the side, chipped on the head, Vine chasing after. Handled by Allison Phelps, so a little member of the Brampton Thunder. And as the puck is stalled, we whistle the whistle for a stoppage. 3 minutes gone in the first period here at the Power Center. Still, both of the Brampton Thunder and the Brampton Thunder in here. Change of line for both teams. consumer facing. I was trying to have a go off of a stick, spiral back from 94. As you see, it's the first day, excuse me, 780 days of my sale from 94. Of course, is a product of the main program, 85,000. For the next four final softball field, where we're kind of the Olympic softball team that went to the 2004 Summer Game in Athens. And it's excited for Hayden here, son. You see that down the shift, so we're back together. Thank you, Tennessee, for the Maracutas. And get far as son, shift down the whole street center. That's the way. Finally, on the Russian Maracutas, and then he's locked this pair with Kristen Coffer from the Catholic Minnesota Duluth. On their national championship team in 2003, that's right, lady after that set, broke up and took things the other way by the Ethelbert. Ethelbert, that's right, with the golfer in the fall 24, that's gone on the first, score of 4. On round near center, here comes somehow with transition. On the right wing side, pulls up, leads to reinforcements, the same as Heffer, Heffer on the back end, walks it down low. Which is to a fan, I think, looking, trying to send, with the target back the other way. Through center comes Lurie. It's the 1-2-2 of Amanda Burns. Lurie trying to set this ball and the target with the save for a center. Defender on the carry through with the blue line, headed for the moment. And a push down four. Half is available, but potentially play a different chase and gets a fresh lead on the ball. 4.5 down in the first. Inside, here comes Kemp. Kemp. And conference performer, multiple times at the battle of the field. So plays softball there as well. Second ace for the round game back in the mid-90s. He passed the center. Pumps wasn't looking for it. It's going to go all the way down. It should be less than the final game. But it's a 4:46 down in the first period. Still no score. This is the back and fumble. Follow the first two broadcasts. Next Saturday, opposite the Mississauga Chiefs. And the last will be around 6 p.m. Here at the Bell Race Center, down the road, right, with the left part of the main, compared to the blue line, a little further, will be down by Kelly Phillips, and we're going to skate far, the lines are deep. Going to skate back together, assistant captain, and a lawyer, and that's right, loses the ball for the season, and the first single game. Well, the Thunder didn't mind it. Still scoring the series over 5-1 in the bottom. Right now, son, here comes Hayes for the step. Right now, captain, just the face-off circle, looks for the fairly steep down low, has Kemp one step behind him. Bump off. By Kemp, the lead pass back in, we're trying to hit Shannon Hennigan, the all-time leading scorer, and hit the other Ohio State. The Thunder able to dispossess the University of Hennigan. So that's one of the seven here. Kicks to the low, fielded there by Dupree, for the hit. But it's down behind the net. It's not with the middle. Here's side of Kemp. Went down to the neutral zone, handled that instant. And some deals are weak one. Case is beginning to this one. Couple of scoring opportunities for both sides, but Pinelli and Edie not tested as of yet. So just inside the blue line, one of the Barracuda zone finally dug through by Tennyson for the visiting team. The Barracuda is at home. The Thunder in the white. The center lead pass is tipped up. It's turned back the other way. Too far to Kathleen Cummins. Man, it came from the wrong side of the red line. So, Wilson is going to be the color here. 15-14 to play in the first period. Still scores. Balls in the line to take a draw for Burlington. Barracuda is able to control it, chipped down the wall behind the net. Now looking for the clear on the near side. They have a back to the flat, a score from the north. Bankford takes over, steps on the head, bounces off the speed. Barracuda is reversed, get a man to bar near the center. Looking to step on the head in the back end, able to get it deep. And as the Fox pauses, sets up the breakup, keeps up the left on the side, Fox on the head, 2 points for this player. And to get it, came the pull for the Barracudas. Call of 2000 present, while Dartmouth comes, and outside of the call, and there's, look like McCutcheon might hit the line a bit too soon, is 7.5 down in a scoreless fourth period. And Zamora back up in the circle, so we go. an excellent independent, and then the other one. Dumped down the left field of Simmons, and that's 4-4 now. The left is reaching forward at center. But he's a ball just by the front of the bench. You can see the spots along the far side. You'll see another advantage in front of him. Without a ball, across the front of the plate. Leading out right, went right back to the center. And Katia's spent for a long run, and now taking over. Ball taking over this time, trying to get back to Kent. So reset it. Back pedal away from the fourth check of Super Cousin. So wheels it back from here on the cage. That's gone in the first three. Then she'll look to reset the action from there on the cover. Shadow up. Waiting for her to come out on the fourth check. Left-wing side of Kent. Ball. Navigating on the left-wing side. It's been pulled momentarily by the cover. Now she gets it deep and left. She'll have to pick up behind her own net. And that shift off the wall, went behind the cushion to the living room, fielded there by Kent, got around the swing of Paul. Paul diagonals ahead, looking for Lloyd. Escape hurries, taken back by McCarthy, and intercepted by Paul. Talking with Becky this week, so she's working on her offensive game. And it's trying to flip it in, clear out of play, so we get the stoppage here at 11:21, playing the first period still. Still, this is this one. Saved with Lyons, comes out there down to center, has Heppard on her right. Still able to free on her left. It's won by Lindsay Vaughn in the Niagara Park. There's a couple of football leaders playing here on the Barracudas, but now Dupree and Lovey. Best team today, one of them. Trying to set that advance support, couldn't get a shot on it. Far side pulls, kick free, wrapped around near center. Harry looking at Marcus. Heppard closes the distance, throws it gets the cooler, just got a long way down, should be nice and on the road team, goes to Russell, 10:58 to play in the first period, so looking for the game to go further. Reminding you here from Becky Kelly in the first quarter, and then Vicky Sonnerman in between periods 2 and 3. The next college broadcast today will be next weekend as well, Sunday, December 16th, in Hanover, New Hampshire, at 60s. Mercury Hills Lakers, Mercury Sport, the man's the nation's top maintained this weekend at UH, will visit Mercury.com with Italy. We can pass through Sim, but the Harrigan is trying to stretch the ice, a lot of couldn't connect, and back together as extra. And all American out of Wisconsin. Makes it on the right to the table, Heppard. His right hand settles it down, but just pass the turkey and cut for Wisconsin. He can go through. Left in a low slump by Eckerberg. Heppard flying the first hook against the bank wall against Kim McCullough. Fish free, one around the fourth center, first gap up. But it rolls back to the red line. The police stosses the top of the back end of Eastman, and from on the other after Heppard. Heppard attempts to chip it deep, and still has on shooting with 10:15 to go in the first. Long lead pass. Again, you see Heppard playing the switch to the edge. Again, fourth up, this time by the bunker. And soon the pound to the heat, and finally steps behind the save for Kelly. Kelly slams on the boats. O'Shane tries to close the distance and chips up the wall. Scale to the blue line. Intercepted, taken away by Captain Hamlet. Hamlet with a shot. Kick save. No, he'll end with Hamlet with a stone gathered by 50s and more. Bubble it for a moment. Allows the family to set up a four check on the front of the scene. And the puck is tied up along with the dead whistle. With 9:46 shot in the first period clock. A couple of good scoring opportunities on recent shifts for the Brampton Thunder. As we see Charlie Anderson alongside Samson Thomas, Brampton in a lot of minutes at the center position here in the first period. Slung down deep, and actually, UCAC player of the year a year ago is a low, a true power forward with great skill, man strength. Chipped away from her to reach, falls slowly. Count. Line a few pushes and more, taken back by Ash, trying to follow the pass of the high center going up there. And chases after the near side, it's Nelson for the Barracudas. Puck pops in the air, settles down to the stick, and Kathleen comes. Down the far, made from the step of the lead. Bumped up against Kelly, pulled out the length of the other stick. One around near side of the front, he steps in on the pitch. Has a few with the Hague down low, and broken up by Kelly. Well, stuck along with the long hand as always, and wants to back out to the road line. Deal it there by actually a rotated back. Kelly, he takes a dunk and head on off of O'Shane. Taking four out of the advantage, the other ice of the money, Larry Cooters, and there's the whistle. 8:50 to play in the first period, still nothing. back to that. That's good. And had a couple of chances to see his friends from athleticism. And as you mentioned, Niagara. I mean, a decent season this year, but they really had an effort coming out of 2002. I think the Dodgers defense team, and Niagara fans, they have fired away and really kicks it to the finish line. Dodgers swinging here in the offensive zone. And here comes the three again between the Super Smiley Center and the Dragon. And we've got a penalty on the far side of the chance as it's over. And it looks like it's going to go the way of the center once again. The offensive zone infraction, the second penalty of the first period. This time it's a hooking against the home team, and so they'll be short-handed. At 8:27 to play in the first period, this time it's an easy goal for now we're going to look at Boston's power play for the second team. We're not able to get much sense. Catherine Towns is going to be doing a nice job on that first four and five situation. Maps will take this one as it is Yvonne, but not one of the corners. Your side comes to Mickey Everett, and the AG Bounce slides on the head. Being bombed through center, quick check away by Angel along the blue line. And the right wing bomb gets it deep. Heading to the front is Aaron Fine. From the sharp angle, and this Fine with a bad save. Here McGovern handles it along the point. Now dealing to Kelly Hart. Down low with Gold Harry. Harry sticking a fastball side to Peter Silver. This side is solid this line. Not the stick of Applebaugh, who comes cheating down. Harrigan on the count, reeling to the high side. If that wants to issue two points, it has to be a pass back door. Trying to hit Kelly Hart on the doorstep, but that one will destroy. And taken down by Anderson Hunts. Hunts hemmed in. Instrom comes over to help out, taken over by Vaughn. Vaughn far side, base goal to go on powerful. 7.5 to play in the first game on score. Vaughn to try and change that. The count, the count on the goal, wrist to see Sasser. That was just wrong. And from Vaughn on the ground, got to hand it in. Trying to reel it to the front, batting on the goal, good adjustment. Leading on the city. Well, good possession as McCullough comes to an end. That settled down and covered on the first here. 7-19 for playing in the period. Burlington looking much smoother on the second time, but it's still nothing like that. Face off into the right. And then the softball slash hockey for Terry. Fuse of motor systems, 93 and 86, both of them 6 feet tall out there together, so a lot of size and strength at this point in that take place from along the perimeter. Kelly's over there trying to hold their ground. This from the Valerie Hall, the Hall of the Tribe. Easy ball save once again, a little snap against Trump. And 37 seconds ago in the half of the game, and we'll get another face off down on the back of the net. This part of the week, and that's the title of Crossing Tank with a few Zamora sisters and Michelle Roy in front. Coming from the whole game, pass to the this is Zamora over to Roy, who pushed it just one with the zone to make the finish of the test. With 20 seconds to go, only half a mile, it's dug through the zone, and Thomas is chased after it. And as Lucky Kelly, he's 8-9-5, so he did not overlap this final year. And as Keller logs on ahead to pushes the ball in middle center there. The ball blows a pound and somehow able to clear it back to the leg of it. We can do it from half a mile. So good looking ball to Tarpa. A couple of good shots and chances. We're not able to vote now. Half a stay of the box and into the play. He's pushed to the ground and pops it down low. So he's on the backhand for the lower losses. Bumpus banking it on ahead. Reaching for the left field of there by Tennyson. Bumpus knocked out by Loftus on earth on the near side. After raising ahead from the local central day, they'll pick up the tennis through the assistant captain. Kick back to Owen, and he's on the new side of the team for the Hoopers. They'll find a lot over the line by Kelly Hart for the Royal Burlington. Hart sweeping down low from the center. We'll have to go to the stick of the ball. We'll have to go to WCHA products getting to the end of the end. We'll look to the red line, we'll look to the blue line. Oh, here comes Hefford coming on the disc. Hefford will let me try to take the puck. Wants it to the front. And back to the rebound, she scores! Dennis Hooker, followed up her own offering, and showing the great finish intends to give Brampton 8-1-9 to lead. And it looked like she had a rear point ceiling. She unhappy with herself, she had to paddle down and close out the goal against Hefford initially, but Hefford was quick hand, spying a loose puck, lying back to Murray Bennett, and Hefford tucked it home, and just like that, bang, bang, Brampton strikes quickly, they had 8-1-9 to lead.
come again. This ever deals with a couple of two. The summer this time really squeezes in and does not concede a rebound this time. It was happy speaking on the right wing side again. It looked like Valley made a fine save on this offering and not given enough to work with. Happy saw the foul and jammed it home quickly before coming to get that skate over to the near post. And Happy skates Brampton to a 1-0 advantage off the ball. Instant two ball up. Had a way back down. Transition as again. We see Harry go down with the ball down on the hand. But Valley has transition. Great shot. Second save. Rebound is fouled. And Allison Fox is able to pull it out of the face. But now we're home just yet. And the team down low rules it up on the first down. First down will chip it just beyond the blue line as Henry will chase it at center. Take it back quickly. Harrigan onside on the left side. The team changing away from him. Harrigan looking for reinforcement. Face pass to the trail of 50 and more. The ball bumped down. Far Summers. Take it back down the pocket. The ball comes to Fox. Fox is possessed. Between the circles, Williams trying to tee it up. That shot through the face guard is sliding away to the 5-9 by the entry. That puck goes out of play with 4:45 to play in the fourth, and Brampton enjoying a 1-0 lead courtesy of Jalen Hill. Eating with his mind and hold it up. He's going back to the front, getting over to Jalen Hill. A short basket will be chased for you. Battle ball, and a match up with Tiffany Hayden. Paul wins that battle and is able to scale the beat. The way it comes down, sends it in front. There's a player there that's Palmer. Keep it going! The man is down. Over the edge of Jalen Hooper. And the tie it one with another foul to play in the post. Seeing an innocent looking play there as Michelle Ryan from the Northeastern Five graduated in 2003, hitting on top. And a man is over. Able to find the scene. And took one pass to answer Jan Hempel's goal, and we'll find it one, going to that break, and we'll leave it here, 15 minutes to go on the floor. See if he first goes for his team, and the chances of winning with this contest, they came in fairly rapid succession, when the goal from Hempel, that powerful sequence was not able to convert. Hempel goes right down the score to get back in line to the lead, and for a bit later, Burlington responds. So, Bomber for the Barracudas, Heffield for the Thunder, and the tie at 1:48 to play in the first period here. And I'll run your Bay and Women's Hockey League broadcast again. The Thunder, Sergio Lopez, and Lee Hagan at the two. Barnes falls out there together on the line. It's just beyond the reach of Christian Barnes. She can't pass the first result. Pass to Airside Ennis. Bomber is held off on the change, and he can't do the same if he gets a beat. Ball on the diamond, Eber looking for a man to run the goal for. Christie's in the wall, Susan Kelly's in the wall, content to get it deep. Can't gain the red line, so Myers in here. Christie's is getting that look back from the other end. McCarthy sending around down from the center. McCarthy denied for the moment after his tackle on the near side. Hickard jamming it, put off by Nelson. The Bears there as well for. Barracuda, he bumped off the skate by opposite number 12-3. Almost flung out ahead of 7. This is one foul goal by Bucky Tennyson. Tennyson on the backhand, a little bit deep with 3 minutes to play in the first time. One Lucia, a couple of players cancel out and go down behind the net. And it's all around the other side of the center. By the half goal, the game could not get the clearance for all for the working hard. I don't know if it generated any offense as of yet, but keeping the attacks in the final in their favor as McLaughlin takes over the header on the net. This is McLaughlin. 39 points in 2003 is one of the greatest power schemes of all time. He's the Roof NCAA champion. Heffield goes left to the side of the three. It's on the ball. Now the offered save, which he held on to in the center. And the ground, which will pop up. There's one of the 2:43 sold out for this period of time. USCHO game 8, by some field, Brampton out there. Another very favorable. Pretty much down side. He pulled the force of expect this time of year. Very strong on the ground from small fellow in the Midwest area. This continues in the U.S. about the ball both down the center's game. Tipped back to center's, headed off down by Anxious. Thanks for the confident 2-8 offense. This is the best defense in the 2007 World Championship in the airport. And by the HF director of the local reform of the Spanish America, she's handled here, back along with him, Harrigan. The first sector made sales, and she was at Ohio State chasing after him again. Here in a CWHL form. Anxious. A long soft to pass, he pulls right around the back, turned back the other way. Lindsey Vine tips it right to the stick of Molly Anston. That way, some of Captain Henry for the Thunder, shifted it on offensive real estate to field it again, pushed back in by Epigraph. That pass got broken up. Here's Carlton who started it right into the key. Pass was all started. He looted the backhand with him all over the near corner. Both one on two, flat up the set. Sprung the rucks in the near corner. Neither team with an advantage. This is 6-3 by Eckert back to Lindsey Vonnegut. Vonnegut leading it up the first set. First down ahead. Here's Harrigan one on one against Angel. Right wing center. Harrigan sweeping along it. Look behind that. Angel shadowing step to step. Harrigan moves up right wing side. Angel got a stick into Harrigan. There's only a couple here against Molly Angel. She doesn't like it too much, but trigger will be in fashion for 2 minutes. Angel with the two former WCHA scholars got together. And Burlington will lead it with a third power play. First one, beat Worcester in the second one, failed Indians. And the Indian company did well to keep them at bay. Kyle Warhoof. Final stages of his first period, CWHO and the USCHO game of the week. Remind if you visit CWHO.ca and find out how you can support this league and you can choose to fight it today as a non-zero season. The CS continue to run now. It's an excellent hand and always a dangerous force in any sort of situation. That field fights in all defensive tackle as Kelly Conway will look like that before going by a pin. Larry. And I'm following Paul. I love keeping on the line. I didn't get deep enough, though. It was coming back out around the Olympics. And Kelly will have to let back to play. But I did tend to play in the first two. And if Becky Keller puts up, and now we're going to hear from the Paul Brown Scott, a longtime member of Team Campbell's defense, and a line of two. Living in Hagersville, we're looking forward to three. One of Susan's a very hot pass from Valley Hall. And really, because she had an opportunity to tip her head. Takes still shadow number 14. Final minute of play here in the first. And it will carry over if necessary. Stolen by Heffer. Going to Hague. Hague right inside. Heffer back to the play. Hague making plays. 21 high in the land. Now with the save, holds on. And as we might have a penalty going the other way finally against the Barracudas as Heffer and Hague. H square becoming a good penalty shot combo there. Indeed, there will be a call on Dallas Hall. And now we're coming up with 6-2. First and fastest on the Barracudas. And we'll see 4-on-4 happen with 37 seconds on the first period play. They start to play the left. Some ball back there will take it. Patrick stays on to help out the team Canada teammate. One back to Chris McArthur, sidestepping with the blue line. Shot is bumped by Roland Rungy Ryan. The ball will now spread the deep. Half a minute to go on the first period. Kind of really in front from there. Was half of hit the side of the net, and it was complete on the fourth line. Okay, the outlet top is McArthur. Swung back near side, hoping for the complete. Complete, pulls it off the wall, trying to get it to the corner with 14 seconds on the clock. We now back on, but bumped off the skates and one minute back on the center somehow. Rotating as far as center to McArthur, allowed back to the complete. Only 3 seconds left as the puck is stalled at center ice. That's the move for the opening period of play, so Jay Hurtick will go to the Rapid Kennedy Center. And Amanda Ball, after that low end for the Burlington Barracudas, after one period of play, it's Burlington 1 and Brampton 1. And first, we have an interview with Becky Keller coming up in the intermission. We'll step aside for a quick commercial break. And on the other side, we'll let Paul Brown University Superstar and our longtime Team Canada defensive Becky Keller take you through intermission number 1 watching the USCHO game of the week. We'll be back in just a moment.
Obviously, there's been growing pains with you, Hickett, coming out, but I think, for the most part, everyone has come together the way that, you know, we had hoped that they would, and just in terms of there being change for our women and placing them in the pipeline has been great. The organization has really taken us under the wing and done everything they can to make it successful for us, and I think it's going to be a great place for us to be in the next few years.
You mentioned some of the former fans that you know, and you're a player who's seen the game through a number of different perspectives, whether it be the national, whether it be in this post that we're saying in the north of the border. If I could give you sort of the commissioner's role, the sort of absolute power for a day, and I told you, you can't pay the players $1 million you can get, I think everyone wants that, but if I gave you an opportunity to change any one thing else and make something different, what would it be?
I think the big thing that the league needs to kind of draw towards is to buy incoming talent. I think there needs to be some way to distribute the incoming talent so that it's equal across the board, so that every team has an equal chance down the road of winning the title. Right now, players can go wherever they want to go, and if we can somehow arrange for that not to be the case, then I think we're going to have to get a couple of years. We're going to keep our load on the road.
Tell me a little bit about this particular Burlington club. When I go through the list, and a lot of these names are going to be familiar to the people watching, including to myself, who's seen a lot of them in college games, who's seen a lot of them at international events. Tell me a little bit about the identity and sort of the framework that's emerged as you guys have gotten comfortable playing with each other for the last couple of years.
Yeah,
I think
it's a great message. I think every player that we have has played the game to the world, so there's a lot of experience with them. And I think it's just a matter of journey right now. We've got two veteran defensemen, and they are playing defense with us right now. They can go to forward, so that's supposed to be a bit of a challenge. But I think the team has been great in doing what they need to do, whatever role they need to follow through. And the players that we've had, a start that have decided are willing to move back on to be a bit of a great position. So, that's a good thing for our team right now. We've got great goals coming in, and we've always been with us all the time. So I think we're going to build off of some of those things, and I hope that we can have a good rest of the season. I hope we're going to be able to do that.
Focusing on your own game for a second, your player has already accomplished everything that you've been able to rely on, whether it be the collegiate level or the national level. So I'm just kind of curious, at this stage in your career, what are some of the things that you're most focused on for?
I want to improve my offensive side of the game. That's something that I have to carry over the last year to 2025. I think it's something that I can contribute to if I work on it, and so that's sort of where I'll be focusing for the next couple of years.
Talk a little bit about personal background. A lot of players that I have is personal from college, and they've got a happy origin story, but their careers began at a different place and a different time than yours might have. Why don't you rewind the clock all the way back? How did you first get into that family?
I actually started playing on that, which is a little bit different sport than similar to hockey with the ability to get a level. And I started in that, and it was part of the hockey organization in the family that I grew up in. So because I was in the organization, my brother was in the organization, my dad took on the role of convener. And his dealings with some of the other conveners here in Clarkson, who their association had got hockey. And he said, I don't think that we should bring that out. And so when he said, I left him out on the clock, and he offered me the option that I would jump out of that. So, and I ended up in hockey, and then went from there.
And it's a road that most of the way to the NCAA route. And the NCAA, I think, for people today, a lot of people that watch the game, they're used to an 18-minute NCAA tournament, they're used to having 30 clubs out there. It's certainly a lot different. Just even 10 years ago, when you were playing at Brown University, to me, how did that balance that process? How you made the decision to go from Canada to the province for an island? So what about Brown convinced you that that was the right place to use it?
I was recruited by Brampton at a small hockey school that I went to in Detroit, and went on a recruiting trip, and I loved it. My whole idea of playing for this school and the professionalism of the team, I really liked it because of the head coach, and I just thought it was a great option. And at the time, most of the girls that I grew up playing with had opted to stay in Canada because I thought this was the best route for the national team. And my dad and I had talked about this discussion before committed to going. And basically just said, you know, in the 4 years, it's something that's going to be amazing. I still can't get something that I'm there. I may not make it. I may not she's been great to get on the ice with the kids and help talk them through all of what we've seen. And I know the nice thing to be found is just so happy to get here. So, you know, we have a great concept and we're looking forward to it again this summer.
But Team Canada with this and Becky Collins, thanks very much for both of you to take a few minutes this week to chat with us. And you probably heard a couple of points along the way. We talked a little bit about human health and mom. You probably heard from one of your kids there what happened while she was doing the interview. So very much thanks to her, privilege to talk to her, as well as Vicky Sandhunter, who we heard from coming up between period 2 and 3. Right here, though, pretty good start to this one. Each team with a goal. Dana Hepburn kicked things off, sitting on the right hand side, and Jamie Hunt to follow the only athlete. And just over a minute later, Burlington was able to respond as Colgate found Amanda Bowers struck back on a feed from the center line between the circles. And that's where we stand. Burlington Barracudas won, Brampton Canada Thunder won the start. The second period, remember, with a couple of players in the penalty box. Kingston scored with 26 seconds to serve for the Thunder. Then it followed with a minute 22 for the Barracudas. So 4-4 for the first half minute, and then we'll see the vaunted Brampton power play for the first time. And this evening, Brian Cole for you in the USCHO game of the week. So glad you can take a few hours out of your Saturday evening to check out what is going on in Northwood Borough, our first ever CWHL broadcast in the season's first week in existence. A competitive start to period number one. And again, we'll keep in mind we have a lot of players and names that should be quite familiar if you follow NCAA hockey or international hockey through the years. Face off the point center. And if we get the whole mix, Burlington in the New York Islanders style a little early. And that could run the Barracudas control in this 4-on-4 with the last 4 minutes, 20 seconds. And if we need it, easy aforementioned Matthew Kelly. Nope. And then it's tackled on the head, kind of stiff in the head. Hey, we're going to block the 4 minutes. Now it's Allison Funks at the red line. We'll sign B to B of McArthur, right back to Funks. And this is where it into space, and McArthur back it all the way, and that'll pick up the line of the attack. And now Minnesota Blue, so it goes back in front of her own net. Burlington now short handed with a 6-4, set on side, and Hay, next to the box. The rifle is a demon, widely used, top off the back glass, and slide away alertly, behind for the ball of all Americans, Tanya Powell. Down to the near front. Thanks for playing patient with the sun. Fall forward, drawing back down by Pavali and a little slow, gathered the back two, next to the ball, turning for a little set on side. At the point center, Hart got another slapper kicked out by Pinelli. And he's back in the lane, sees to the ball to net right now. Far side to Free. Trying to go cross ice was Heppard. He was left away by Amanda Barr. Barr back on the head. Lindsey Vaughn is looking for a change and started all the way down. And then strides back to Pinelli. 10 seconds left in the battle for the battle. And that's a rich power play. For the Raptor Canada Thunder. 1:15 down in the second period. Time at 1 apiece. Kingston Bowers for the Rufus on the left wing, gets a keep at first down. Shift around far center, goes through the stick of Pepper, see the Rufus, and the box can fall, and Sutter Hartman settles it down, via back to Pepper. Pepper on the center pass, in front, and Sutter stuck, rebound is fourth just wide, by the way, you play between the circles. Next one from the front, Rufus kicked out by Pinelli, who was doing yeoman's work here early in the second period, Burlington with a desperation pull, just under 2 goal by as the home team picking up its energy here in the early going, a little bit of frame. We'll see here, and that was stalled, and we got some of the Thunder for the time being. As you saw, some of these athleticism on display, but the stalling saves to keep us a 1-1 game. This is going to be the call, we're going to drive back to the left. But Sidney Eve, which are the two goaltenders on this team, both pretty tall, Danny Clark out of Maine, and Sidney Eve, they're both multi-sport starters. Well, she was at Maine, was actually the starting goaltender of the women's soccer team, in addition to being the starting goaltender for the hockey team. And Richard E., an Olympic softball participant in Athens in 2004, was attending that here for the Thunder. Also, Brock, Julian, through center, feeding Tiffany Hay. Hay, losing on a quick step along the blue line, not providing support. Hay back on now. Hay trying to split through the defenders, kicking into the slot, taken away by Becky Chanson. Chanson on the head, man, too far for Christie's as well, so all the way down. And the icing waves off. As left is chopped to free. McArthur looking at her options, left wing center and Priest clearing this. Fired back under the rifle pin, and then there's Loftus at left wing. Loftus shooting from center, blocked by Hanson. Becky Hanson, Priest, and Loftus is here. Whatever. And we talked a lot about NCAA, but the CIS is also well represented here as well. That's the University of Ottawa, that has played in this lead in both his prior incarnation of the NWHL and, of course, the winning inaugural season of the CWHL. Our side chief of the world, not out, killed by Zana Hall for the moment, then fell asleep. Mario Strand, Paul Anthony, Paul Wadding in on E. Lady thought about playing after Paul Elf was hired in. Kelly Hart closed the distance. We mentioned earlier, Christy Zamora, as a senior, a guard with Meredith Wilson incidentally, they are out of the size of those two players. He plays in a round game run to the 2002 NCAA finals. He's been going to a very slow start, about 6'6 and 1 of them. Zamora just can't find. And right with 35 goals, that season, arguably the most decorated player not to be named a nominee for the Penny Tennisman Award, but he was named the most outstanding player of the 2002 Frozen Four. Still the only player ever to come off a team that did not win a national championship to be named the MVP of that event. Well, the Tennessee Kings had goes through the air. Bonnie did get a touch from the Mason. Bonnie then picks up a little care about a little bit of confusion. I hope his brother did put that in the Mason. So the shot was taken on ease from a better angle. Line now coming up, this is 300 to race. Length from Cook to 44 to level. On the far side, the chase is on. And now it's taking a little bit of 7-4. He feels it is near side. Coming on the pitch, and can't see the end of it. Over there and flung around by Fenster. The first check here on Bear Food, a hard working group, as it is right at level through the NCAA system, a number of pretty solid ones in there. He's nominated Clive and now the Hall of the Indiana final, along with Vaughn, also Chris Simone. Christy, that is, from Brown, Tim McCall, 100 plus points scored in a Dartmouth final. Sam Harrod, 160 points, all time leading scorer at Ohio State. Kelly Hart, 100 points in her career at the Indy State. First side face-off, granted defensive zone. Can come to the conference defensive forward and range the ball back. And with a head-to-head pass, too far to go, and he's still at center ice. Now they're from the center color. Now Amanda Bauer, who logged the one goal for the Burlington Barracudas in period number one, gets up some runway and ended up that runway from the bad angle from the fourth one in front. And there's the tower, and he takes over. Even Francis from Bauer, who works the tower, trying to settle his runway and head down to the front, put the back of the net instead. And it turned out with 4:12 to go. First of all, Donnie sees in the second period. They were trying to catch a transition for the other breaker in the first two minutes. And then Burlington seemingly taking the look the other way. As we're still tied in the heat. A couple of quick strikes for both teams. Hence a throw to Fever. And Amanda Barr from the center area. The way that Iron Fruit is both coming about 90 seconds of time late in that first period. Left to center, Connelly comes Tiffany Hayden. Hayden, Donnie. That left pushes it near St. Christopher Barton. The Barton has space for Connelly. Connelly with an equal save left the lead on the A's side and fell out of the zone. As Oakland with the last end to play. He has it far side to Allison Fox. Fox on the head man. Passes to the left and picked up along the red line. Chip to the blue line and down. Oakland are using a long reach against Anderson. Makes yourself available down the low. Oakland are kind of returning in full. Teeing up was McCutcheon putting in a shot over the front line. Now, the rolling puck is pushed to the blue line and out to center. Back to get Allison Fox. Fox from the BDE 5 minutes down in the second period. USCHO game loop here. Inaugural season of the Canadian Women's Hockey. All four forecasts of the coach of the game from the CIA. The game couldn't get plenty of loops here. And transition from the Barracudas. All right, it's seven. It's stuffed in for six. And Edie was sitting behind that for only an extra. Extra near side of Eric Ostrander. Winding on ahead, delivered by Keller on the quick pivot. Wheels to Van Hall, right back to Richard Keller, returning near side of Hall. Hall, of course, a forward by trade. Looking Burlington does not have a lot of, is experienced defenseman as the puck is faced. So, we heard Becky Keller talk about they are using a number of converted forwards on the blue line, including Madison, who was in their collegiate career, the all time leading scorer in the history of the Niagara. This is 142 points in 144 career games, including 77 goals. Leading scorer on the team as both a junior and senior in the junior season, and it was Niagara Dance, 2-4. Some Harlow will stay in the face-off circle. Looks like Bonnie's going to be chased and see how they lose the payment. He's not playing a very high percentage in the circle on this evening. Thanks for pitching down low from that blue line position. It's not going to be a solid seal off the front, but now Keller getting a high on the glass, Bonnie's on the hook. Now he's going to try to catch up and begin to icing. Doesn't quite get there, though. One step late is the Ohio State star, so we'll get the stop. Ben Harry, All-American and nominee for the Penn Task Award in 2006. Somebody teamed with Jenny Carey, who was the goal scorer of Harry in the set. Set up participants and then receivers who would carry Ohio State's offense. playing with Trey. Here are the teams that have it from Burlington. It was shut to the area by Larry Dupuy. He's down the side by Fidel. But near side, Dupuy, a good steal. On the breakout attempt, some of the center balance intercepted by Kells. Dupuy then got it. Support Thompson Fox for a kick out of his own. Maybe a 2-on-1 if they hurt. Carrigan went on the side. Kelly Hart ran it in. Carrigan with a turn line that Edie is so he does not. Can see how he went in 13-38 to play in the second period. Still 10 at the right piece. So this league consists of 7 franchises divided into 2 divisions. Brampton, Burlington, Mississauga, and Vaughan comprise the Central Division. Montreal, Quebec, and Ottawa make up the Eastern Conference, if you will. There are a couple sort of cross-division matchups, but the final play is done within our own division. It's like old style baseball in the U.S. And as Collins is kind of forcing their way down to see those dynamics, and just before the final up at third, right wing side, Hager, a full head of steam, Collins fired it in. Hey, turns on the field, stop being a shot. Hurley with a save, but rolls in there, T.J. Hurley. In full fight on the right wing side, it will stick on Collins, then granted its second lead is 2-1. I talked to Tiffany last night, because I remember I was coming up. He said she gave me something good to talk about. So 17 and right makes good on the finals for us, as our good friend out of Edmund P is flying on the right wing side. And twice that, you see players for the Brooklyn Thunder in isolation on the right wing house of six. Kind of late developing plays. Heffer was able to stand in a long rebound. In the first period, there, hey, she gets from a free. You see, Hall was kind of fighting it all the way. Wasn't sure if he had it. And a trickle of Columbus is Tiffany Hay picks up the talent. His first round of transition. Ran a down on pass, pokes up the way. Back to another one from Thunder. Opening things up for him. We get a stop. It's a 12:49 in the second period. So Tiffany Hay, another on the column. Actually had a senior season plan to get cut short. Not a broken foot earlier than he comes in. He'll pull out 14 million for the big game as a senior. But show audio effects 2 years later. Okay, skated strong as he powered to the goal and bounced. The go ahead, time is 4-0. 2-1 Thunder. As he tipped out to center being man of ball, the long goal score for the Barracuda. And pedaling together was Kristen McConnell, and he'll be back. He was the Warrior Loftus. Loftus out of Queens University. An OUA All-Star in 1999. And a couple of stints to the old NWA show, the old Mississauga Ice Bears, and then the Thunder. As Barr, nice move to free yourself. Barr walks in, you stop practicing. Rebound is loose and splits up the seam, not out of his own. Upsets Jennison, checking on the back end as he walks her way down the right wing side. Jennison sweeping down low, bodied off by Loftus. MacArthur scoops in to intercept from Van Henry, and Ostrander sets sail to set. Lead pass from MacArthur, too far for Ostrander. This could be an icing call on the Thunder. 12-1 to play the second period as Williams said again. Similar to what they did in the first period, trying to respond to a Brampton turn after Hayes hits Stateman to the lead. Going back to Laura Loftus, they should hold experts in the CIS. She is the one, if you want her home taken care of, and give her a reference to her, she makes an interior decorator when she's on skate for the Brampton Center. Off the draw, get free, just poke out the center. There's a lot of contact to step his lead to the end. He's putting the call there, not for a cover. Support comes from in from barreling up the center. The piece of an angle, bouncing puck in a slot, that's tipped up. That's what retreats the head off the pussies and more. Disorganized play here. And as Kelly will kind of sell things down, and a long time team Canada teammates some more pressures along the fortune. Right wing side of Nielsen, chucked away by Allison Funk, but Nielsen Funk on edge, let's settle down for the moment. And then slung back to the neutral zone, Kelly deals it up for Christie Zamora, tips off his stick to the offensive zone, makes it looking longer, reels it back in on the inside of where he'll be free. The three on Canada's on the team in 1998-2002. He's kind of taking a step back, also a moment for these days. In the center of the sports team, but still, flat out big home on the ice. I think we talked about this, those who are on the national team or players who were, but a lot of these players, in fact, all of them still play for the love of the game and play at an extremely high level. And he comes to the four misses with me. The outlaw of lightning is Heffer. Heffer had a long goal in the first year, but he couldn't have moved to his penalty, so potentially dumped in and had no final chance. McCullough deals it right inside the Lindsay Vaughn. Reverses into space and will let Hammer to chase after.
She's playing anytime she has hair goes out there. She's going to be trying to create transition. And then I think the air surface using her speed, not just some of the similar things that she did in around the state. And there's a great score there for Jackie Butler's up in. Taking away by that bench, playing some good defense in her weight position. Hey, has her former teammate on the right. Here comes that full head of steam, trying to step around a defender. Throws down hard, the foul by Hayes, saved by Pennelly. And the puck comes flying off of that comes flying off of some rings as Pennelly was backed by one defender in the crease. A lot of contact on this play, so if you can stop to the last of full speed, it's probably going to have to be able to kind of thing. And as we mentioned, one of the first goal scorers in Palace Hockey, 30 goals a year ago, including a number of late key goals. But what about this? Third period, overtime, over and over again. She only had big damage before they won the last season. And her final stats are 30 goals, 46 points, and we can get named the conference player of the year in 2007. So the Diego offensive performance in the ECAC in 2007. He started protecting the Yellow Cummins. Before it comes from Kathleen Pink. And was in conference all-star in 2001. Hey, trying to drag it to the front. Trying to step in the foul comes from the guard. But that didn't lose Pennelly, who was steady right in the crease. So Hayes showing the offensive side here in the second quarter. Has the one goal looking for number two. And as left is trying to bank it in. The low is free, set up down by Becky Dennison. Dennison's headband pass tipped away. Sent all the way in. It was calmly down a little bit after a flurry first by the center and then by the Burlington Barracudas on the swing. It's 2-2 run midway point of the hockey game. Peeking out is McArthur. Nice pass in space. This shot by Kathy Healy doesn't go through. Handley settles down to Anderson Pump. And they try to protect the case. Taylor wrestles Handley off his skates. Dorothy Handley was the varsity hockey basketball soccer player at Morgan College in the late 1990s. She's still flying her trade against Tyler on the corner. Finally, the fifth place. Back from Mims, and then leads to Mars. Allows him all the way down. I thought people were in, so he didn't go in. And Fox will fly it back the other way. Rebound Hall will take over and bump it near the side of the count. They're allowing a lot of ice time as always. Directing traffic on the headland pass. Tip by Christmas and Mars, and then a corner. Here comes Paul showing her offensive instincts, looking into the foot, saves her by E, and she's able to collect the foul. And there was a second opportunity there for a moment, and Cindy Eady able to get the cover. UConn CIS Wolfsburg played at Lincoln Laurier in 2001 to 2007, was actually MVP of the OUA in both 2001 and 2005, also the CIS Rookie of the Year as a freshman in 2001, Cindy Eady. Based off to her right, center home out there to take it. And again, is able to win it. I recall one case with a 61 and one his left side. We heard from her between periods 2 and 3. A very defeat out there, making the offense his own back to first side. The right hand have ever. Turner Silver has a goal tonight. After the stick check there by 50 and one. The three comes over to provide support. The silent pass rolls through the Fox for a loose set. Kicks to his knee. Heffer is looking for the jam home. Heffer now sails it in front. And it's broken up and taken back by Nelson for a Burlington. Blob on left wing is down. Handle came to red line. This should be an icing call. And there's a whistle. 7:55 to play. Game the second quarter. As we look at one thing that Jada Heffer does well. After the international game, the last finishers of MSC. We talked about the goal in the 2002 winter game. About the 2000 World Championship that was played in Ontario, Canada down 2-0. In a third period to the U.S. in that gold medal game, Heffer scoring the equalizer. And that one could bring Canada back in first overtime the game. They would win in overtime 3-2. We talk about goal scoring. That is a dominant one. There are very few players, a few and few it seems, that come into college every year. They have a little bit of problem on the ice surface just outside time of 28 feet. A problem there, but in the college game, there are very few players year on year that you can count on to score a goal. Something you think about today, maybe the guys to Sarah Vianco, or maybe a couple of players who are purebred finishers and just draw their scores. Now, Heffer is one of those players, a player that if you put the puck on her stick anywhere inside the hash mark, bad things are going to happen to your opposing defense, and I don't care if you want to give any room to. So, still. After 3 up the game, they haven't been in touch with the Brampton score call the same thing. I heard, but still, it becomes more game. The of those classic players you expect to be in Vancouver in 2010, landing on home soil in the winter Olympic game. The fact that he also has some of his sons in going to take a play. And the guest to the analyst, so Crystal Hager coming to do the interview. And Lindsey Vonn takes advantage, we're going to get back to the court. Kicks around the other side, pitching his left, his puck comes up in the air, a 6 foot frame of Julian Anderson reaches to take position. That's lost to Angel on the red line. That's followed by him from the south. Jason will get the first touch, time for us to take the line. And the game comes. And Tiffany Hager working on the first hook, Burlington surrounding. And they get Kalani through the first run. That's Kelly Hill, all over the red line. Ladles it in deep. Carter has excellent left wing. Carter closes the distance. Turn around along the end of the net. Kind of dig a field. Where is that the side of the net? And Edie will follow technically to be secure. With a 7-17 to play in the second period. And Brampton with the fact that Tiffany Hayes, second period channel, still enjoying a 2-1 lead in this one. And a reminder again, next week, same time, same place. Hopefully, the game will be fun this week. This is from the Chiefs. Among those, they bring to the table. San Diego Falls, Team Canada, and Sarah Wolf, those are the local attendants. That's their hit mining talent, Sarah Wolf. Up top, well, they only have Jennifer Voss, a lot of good friends from college. Sherry Piper, of course, the Team Canada and Dartmouth, among others. Jennifer Rosmondi, and out of Harvard as well, and all comes up to form in 2006. They are left on defense as Princeton player. Brian Davis, also an all conference defender at Brown. So a number, again, of tremendous players in both the U.S. and Canadian college system. And national teams as well as the Chiefs will take on the final next weekend. Right here is the Falcons trying to play offense. So Chiefs standing low. Lance Hector is standing in front of the lane. The Chiefs can't get it to look. He goes to the front somehow. This game is the Lampus standing low. Hector trying to protect. Turns it on short handle set. And the wave off to Ellen. And the ball shoots up the final pressure applied by Sam Hunter. Ball side at the Warriors in 3 now. Next step against Stephen Taylor. Learn Sarah, but the Chiefs are operating in the front. It's still long possession in the offensive zone here for the home team. And Sarah Hart checks the back end of the other hand after his. Ball held all over. At the other way, comes Captain Hayden. Hayden is trying to center. Captain comes with the goal. The pass didn't go through. Transition the other way. And the ball was in danger with all that offensively. And it's just an end of the air by Cindy Rudy trying to catch up on the near side wall. Slammed over by a couple of defenders. Got it to the point. Slung down low, chasing after the cross on the net, since they got a foot, leaving the corner to some air, using another poke check to Catherine Kaufman on the target. And we're finally a penalty here. Got a pretty physical second period, but not much in the way of whistles for inflation. This one looks like it's going to go the way of the Burlington Bar Cooter, who should have double skater down below the end line. And so we get a look at, for the first time, a full power play for the Brampton Thunder. They play guilty party just for the Cuba penalty. That's what's up, Christie's role, 93 for the Barracuda. Is the ball in the city at the moment? It's off the top in the neutral zone. So McArthur is out there, and in one point, it says Pence, Cave, Anderson, Pence. Anthony Kaufman as well. It's Burlington still hanging, working at three. Bonnie and high point fan of Melissa. Take it back, Bonnie Allison Funk. Fox takes the return pass. And the charter member of the American Funk goes right by to Julian X. Passes the ski on the right wing. Stands on the brakes and the foul is thrown. Slides around to the near side. Funk comes down on the pitch. Help from Hay and Connolly are both fighting down low. Hay finally on the forehand, able to run it through, wants to sell it. Hay behind it. Connolly heads to the front. Hay near side of Fox. Fox on the quick swing, up top, Chris McArthur. McArthur right back to Allison Fox, skipping a pass far side, Jay. And he's got two shots to sell his savings both. Rebounds up, Allison Fox, they're playing a double, it's 3-1. Excellent job of composure there by Fox. as they keep their feet in the air, the name of the area is so to glove it down without committing a hand pass or was that you get to shoot. You can glove it down smoothly and finish the rebound without taking a time, without running a foul of hockey long, and was able to do both. And for Allison Fox, the role of Aaron Ontario, skating on the blue line over the body since inception, comes up with a power play 10, follows up the full box of that, and his keeper looking for more off his head. Great save by Brawley, even on his left, in the long slot, the first grab of all, turning his head for the game, firing through heavy traffic, and was blocked by Clemson. And the Thunder feeling it now, up 3-1 with 3.5 to play in period number 2. Skating out of harm's way, comes to Nicky Etherbrink. Left hand side of Lurie. Gamora heading to the front, just back to the key, but right behind the antenna receiver. Coming down low is Jellison. Extra. Takes it calmly away, but can't get away from Kelly Zamora. Lurie heads to the back wall. Trying to jam it up there. He's got near center to Lurie to play. Nice lead pass, here comes Heffley to Strong. Heffley to the dangle pass, but recovery defense. If it couldn't evade the last defender, and won't keep on molested against the net number. Instead, it will be Lurie behind her own net. On the side of the corner. He's trying to get to the middle. Bond steps inside of the funnel. She might be off to the races. Ball with a full head of steam. One, two, three, shot. Eating with a penalty save. And he's been following her just enough, but did not cover the penalty. And his ball right side of the left corner will go back a little bit. And Strang is slinging it in for the Thunder. 2.5 to play in the second quarter. Find a little whistle here is every time you see the case of the goal or a big three, it seems like those teams kind of string the legs. As you saw, Ball again, the Canada's Falcons for all the teams at one and a half, buzzing at the other. Both today and E coming up with a couple of fun saves. Panthers still with a 3-1 lead, 2:20 to play in period number 2. Here comes Bobby Hall with our name Sunday. And that is this season over, 91 and 94 yards. Defended off for a moment, McArthur. Thanks it off the wall, couldn't get it past the ball, along the blue straight, far side down, makes some more. Kind of tug wide at 3, just put check away, ball in support. Shuttles it deep, puck by play in the air, rolls around the dance, and throws it off to the stick of Campy Handley. Those fans trying to make themselves available to center, and I thought the wall was to the neutral zone, but a minute 50 to play in period number 2. The side of Thomas, who comes back to Kelly. That's what she wants to look for from the offense. Here she comes down the line. Pass moves by Kelly. The three of this side. Eve, the pass save. And as Becky Kelly was showing on the offensive instincts here, you go back to her collegiate career. In a short time of schedule, Becky seems like maybe she was only played about 25 or 30 games. Two whole year, she knocks 23 goals and 49 points. She wants to be being able to talk to Thomas Coates. As you mentioned, a teammate. And a classmate of Katie King as well. Wish off the top of kick save by E. Rebound is stuffed by E as well. As Kelly Hart, former Eagles, from now to fish one along, but Edie would have none of it. This is both Edie and Amanda Cullen. 12 goaltenders for this Thunder club. Coached by former Northeastern player Bowen Rosa, which was skating for the Huskies back in the mid-1980s. Wes Washington is the skipper for the Burlington Barracudas. Lead pass to center. Just everyone, finally taken back on the puck. Four of Burlington along the long blue line. Strong going on in the neutral zone. The men's 15 to play in period number 2. We'll hear from Vicky Summerhauer coming up in just a moment. Here comes Kelly Hart. It's a long move. Makes things pulling on the side. That's what Vicky does well on. Mark the playmaker. Harold and Schneider. The finish is a great opportunity for the Barracudas to climb it in one, but Harold just couldn't get it home. Here they come again. Harold is stepping to a move. Comes by. From the angle. Shoulder save by Edie. And she curls it to the naked final as Lindsey Vaughn was on the doorstep. On the clock. Wholesale changes for both teams. Ranting with goals from Heffert. Hague and Allison Fox most recently on the power play. They have all the first two attendants. They were the Burlington Barracudas. First on the CWHL broadcast in the USCHO game week. And it's been fun to see some of these great players, both past and present, in terms of NCAA, CIS, and the national team. They were looking all over the time. That didn't go through. So the Hart touched the carrot between the circles. He goes up to Heffer, and Heffer shuttles it the rest of the way in. Kelly stares at it, and it crosses the end line. Mason's going to be the call here. 34.6 on the landings on the period 2 clock. just the whole weight somehow, and pulls the ball and makes up in face off down. And then finally, the ball is on the somehow. Turns shot didn't go fully to loosen this between the circle. Maybe bad for the corner, and this one was kind of an effort, where the three collapse spins away from the four foot, loves the ball with 22 remaining in the period. Dog game seven, the three is available somehow. And so one step ahead was the first second away of the ball. Somehow, final shots, 63%. Inside they come, the three kind of roll it in on goal, and now you'll get the cover 9.1, so many times for the Thunder to win a draw and set up a shot home for any moments of period number two. And Lindsey Vonn, who is the West Boston's go to face-off participant, will come out. But it's not the same as the Boston Summer Hall has been lethal between the two winners on the draw. So, wins this one fully. The first pass of the three with 5 seconds. Fires through the screen. Nicely back in it. Rebound between the circles in the last one. Dug through by Lindsey Vonn. That's going to do it for period number two. So, a pair of girls for the Thunder. Tiffany Hayes taking on the opening side. Ellie Funks. On the power play has backed it up by a count of 3-1 after two periods of play. And as Thomas had a chance to catch up with Rapid Thunder captain and all-time team captain for Vicky Sonnenhaar, so coming over to Vicky right now between periods number 2 and 3.
My guest is Rapid Thunder forward and all-time team captain. Thank you so much. Thank you. Thanks so much for joining us. I'm going to start with your current team. And then for the start this year in the inaugural season, the Canadian Women's Hockey League, and all the international events have sort of prevented this team from having the full complement every day. But you know, taking us out of the dressing room, how does this group of players kind of feel about where they stand right now?
Well, we have a pretty
small
bench, and one of the Canadian women's games we could be short a couple players as well. We've come pretty close. We've come close there, and we think that, maybe we'd like to have those games that we want to talk about, but I think that we learned that early in the season, and we're just starting to get better and getting better every day. So I think we'll look forward to the next few games and keep trying to improve and things.
You're sort of playing a game for a long time, so I understand the value of having a place like this to play. And for some of the younger players, some of the players who may be in college today who are looking to get back to this league tomorrow, how critical is it that an organization and entity like this be successful for the game of
Women's
League?
Well, it's definitely important for this league to be successful because there's, a lot of times people just look at when they're playing and look at the national team that everybody needs a club team to play for. And that's what's been so important in making the national team so successful. Those players are playing in the club system. And we definitely need the players to come out from college and play in the league. And that's the way it's going to become, it's going to go the next step and become a professional league, having those players come back and keep making the league better. Definitely from a coaching perspective, we never have the team that we do have representing Canada at the World Cup. So those players playing the club system, keep pushing the players and making them better.
Well, it's a national team, and when you look at the makeup of this Brampton roster, it's certainly something that stands out in the first part and former members of the Canadian national team. But we also have a few members from the U.S. national team as well. And obviously, everyone knows about the intense rivalry that goes on between those two countries. Just take me inside sort of the dynamic when you two actually end up in the same uniform for a couple of games.
Well, it's nice to have a
lot of
teams. It's always
nice
to have a
to be able to play in front of a captain rookie. So the relationship feels a little bit for the person in the background. I think a lot of people that have watched or listened to my program and certainly familiar with the NCAA background. But players that are starting out today, the players are coming nice short of all options in this game. They're starting the game. You obviously started in a different type of game for women's hockey. You are the captain. How did you first get involved in the sport? And sort of how did you find your way in sort of the formative stages of your career?
I've always loved playing, and I think that my dad and me started playing when I was young, and I played U.S. hockey and kind of just pushed on U.S. hockey when I was 8 or 9 because I was a girl in the area. I played minor hockey in the Chicago League, and basically I always just used to, play the team and play in the top of the local competition. When I was 17, 18, I got started. I went to Maxwell Fellowship in Beacon University in Boston, and I stayed there for a couple of years. And, gosh, it was so long ago. It was really just to get developing. There were a few strong teams and not the most biggest competition at the time. And that was the Burlington NCAA Expansion League. And the chance to make it came here and play, to make it here and play, because I think that was where the top level of the people that at the time I was going to get to. But Jackson back in the game was just showing up right here to competency. And that's kind of where it kept going. And 2019, 89 was my first year for the national team. So I just really had a really fortunate and played on some good teams and some good coaches and had some great people in the area, I guess. And, really kind of pushing it further, so I was involved in a time where I was definitely really just beginning, going becoming an international IHS world championship event, and just kind of the way it goes with the world.
Let me ask you about a couple of years that you spent in the Houston. A lot of my audience is spoiled with the college game today. They're used to a reality where there's 8 teams in the NCAA tournament, there's 30 teams across the country, there's a Western Conference, and a couple of Eastern leagues. And as you said, it's a much different reality when you came in and played with Boston. So you made an impact with 51 goals in 1989. I don't know if it stood for 16 years, but tell me a little bit more, tell us a little bit more about the way women's college hockey in the U.S. was like in the late 1980s.
The closest thing to professional, I would think, and it was practicing every day. It was, literally just getting into some training, office training, other than the antibodies, business, and all that stuff. It was fun. It's just for women's stories, I think, Kevin, Northeastern, and UNH, that were really compelling. And besides that, we went undefeated in the freshman year. We went undefeated that year, and not to say that there wasn't competition, there was some close games, but there was, basically 2 teams. And it's just unbelievable to me now to see how far it's gone and it's grown with all the teams. And, I don't know, we didn't get a chance to travel and play in Colorado and Wisconsin and the Dakotas and the Kelly, even though we. It was always just in the ECAC, and it was fun. It was a great experience for me, but I think a lot of being homesick and wanting to get back to Chicago, and it kind of regretted it. I think that's kind of the reason why I decided to leave into New Jersey.
Obviously, you've been a long-standing member of the Canadian National Team. You've been in every World Championship, played in every local games as well as the 98. So I ask you to pick out a couple of key, defining moments from that list. And I kind of was probably too difficult to have a couple of minutes, but if I try to make you encapsulate some of the few things that really do stand out at this point, what would they be? What would they want to be the top of the list?
Okay, some of the standard is I played in the 1990 World Championship, but I did get cut in 1992, and I think a little shock to my system. I was so sorry for myself for a long time. I think it was maybe one of the better things that happened to me and made me realize that if you walk up and work hard and that things like this can happen, and I guess it really flipped in any way. You can face obstacles, you have to overcome them. And so that really, it really stands out. Maybe in the, well, it is a topic, but 1998 Olympics were huge for me, and just being in Japan, where my grandparents, 50 miles from where my grandparents grew up, was pretty special. And definitely the 2002 Olympics, where we were so many exhibition games for the Americans, and
And I was thinking about the cage, and I put together with Hill, and we're sending down his cage, dealing with the point of extra. Right back for Hague, moving down the name of Sillian Wall. Now his help from Pelt is going behind the net. After Summer Jacket, we get Chrissy's only far son. That's getting rubbed down. Going back to the back wall, picked up there by Valerie Hall. Hall. Gonna stick together with Tiffany Hague, and he'll pop back high in the air and hit the net above the glass. So we're gonna stop it. First minute of play here in the third period, so Brampton 3 and Burlington 1. Somehow, after they take the glass, somehow typically playing between Dupree and Heffert. Three festive, attention to two of the assistants. Make the time. The Parker tees it up, just to flex it by Dupree. He said, like, being Heffert, you're cruising between the circles, couldn't get the shot on it, so he went off the side of the net. Somehow banging it as well. Dupree, it's a banging it! And now he's still flying over on the first line. The flurry here by the Heffert. And it's 7 gone in the period. Dupree far side, center high, center comes up a good time. The near side, McCarthy's leading forward against Lindsey Bunny. Looks like Bunny had to get a tie to get a change. Doug flew up, and then all somehow playing making again. Puts it back to the defense and sets the puck off the near side wall. Turning outside of the room. Nice indirect pass hit for Lucy Ford. Nudged it in front, nobody home for the defender. That's the way comes Kelly Hart getting a clear. Lindsey Vine it up time as they look for a change here. Bend and half on in the period of CDE will cover up the camera. And as Harrigan had come feeling bad. Now let the defender complete their change of the play. They saw kind of left on you. Kelly Vine is out there between Lorient and Bauer. Lorient and Bauer combined for the longer Burlington to Kelly in the first period. A shot from distance, Forks one. We'll sign Allison Fox against the insurance goal as of now for the third and a power play in the second. Pending with a couple of fourth quarters, 7 passes, 5 to 9. And on the near side, it's Molly Angstrom. Angstrom striding through center, for this speed as he hits the line. It's on the center. He's the most that can only reach him for, gathered by Kelly's and Roman sent back the other way. The scene from Sean is saved by Edie as he reaches for it. He's able to hit the cover. Seal has supported Sondheim and the Buffett. Down when it goes to Heffert, giving goals and free reaching for it between the circles, couldn't come up with it. Far side, they spin it. See, Chrissy's a more underneath, hanging out from there. Sondheim is trying to look it free underneath. The round star, we finally get the stoppage here. 16-26 to play in the third period, and Brampton is still enjoying a 3-1 advantage. Participants set here. Every shot of goal in the third period is gone the way of the barrel. It is officially. There's McArthur. Allows it. Nice play by Dupree to free himself. This shot through traffic. Did not lose the time. Dupree comes 7 after the down there. Issue for this play. This is able to fight it off with the stick. Far side up the wall of McArthur.
long range. That was denied by Lindsey Vonn. That's the five by Sonny Miller for a slam. She digs it between the center. And the back trying to invade the camp of the field. And there's a good example. I'm going to fight it out to center at least for a cooler. 15-51 to go in the third period. And Brampton still enjoying the 3-1 lead as it's hammered hard off the glass and down. Long is in the air as it scores the distance. Basically, it's going to be the color. Long can get covered. And 15-43 on third period clock. And minor out coming broadcast next week. We've got one each for one post grad and one time. December 15th. From the same facility, the same Brampton team and the co host to have the Broncos, Sammy Joe Florida, Sherry Becker, and the rest of the Mississauga Chiefs. And then Sunday at 1 p.m. Eastern Time, we'll be at Hanover Hampton. We'll have another college schedule as a monthly with the locals, led by Canadian National Team Steward Megan Augusta, team coming with Brent McPhee Gray. And then U.S. National Team is Sarah Parker. Those are between Brampton defenders. Bonnie takes advantage of the first return. The puck is on there. Settled down from Portsmouth. That was his time in the lane. For a side to Lloyd, 5-3-8. Again, a shot from distance. That puts the side of the cage as you have an air force steal. That is a mark. Getting together with Kenton Henry on the other side. The puck batted first. Settled down and gathered by Allison Pumps. That's the line of back out to center ice. Taken over again by the Barracuda for a little distance shot. Easy stick save that time. Once again, picks up. Puts around their side to Henry. Looking for a clear is Kathleen Cox comes down a little bit. That one's nice to go to that camp. Finally, angle on the left wing. Cox is available. Strictly for right wing center. Tipped away by Jennison. Cox catches up. Stands on the break. Blows the tunnel. Comes down to her feet. While the team is changing behind her. Finally, support arrives in the corner of Julie Nelson, Tiffany Hayes. Kathleen Cox still staying with her on the other side. Trying to keep it in the zone before it's finally forced out by Jennison. Jennison along the red line. Wings the offensive hand. With help from Christy Zamora. Here's Zamora on an island trying to split three defenders. Easily dispossessed by Chris McArthur. And McArthur, indirect pass, Cox wasn't expecting it. Tipped back the other way. Zamora and Nelson now chasing after McArthur. It holds the ground pounder. Ladles the back end of the pass. Trying to get by to Tiffany Hood. 14 even on the third period clock. Hague now. Hague again on the far court. Wins the race to the puck on the driveway of third. Lost on the poke check moment somewhere. Well, back to Hague on the right wing. Bounces off his skates and so forth peel off and head for a shame. As Keller skates back to the left. He only needed to eat a man from the line. He plays behind the ball. This goes to this. He should be racing coming on the Barracuda. And there's a whistle. 13 and a half to go on the third. So Hufford, Hague, and Fox for the fumble. And Amanda Barr for the Barracuda. 3-1 back in the top since on day 26. For the home team, 19 for the visitors. Now he has a call here. Wicks and Hall is back out for the ticket. And Lindsey Vonn is leading down to meet him again in the defensive zone circle. One back, and then it's still on the other side. Carrigan trying to play the first point. He can find it so far in the third field. He can find a stress for Peabody in the second. Peabody tucked in front of him with a stick down and all was just around his head. He was probably only about to do three and finally with a full extension stadium. And a nice no-look pass from Hinton down the road. Well, he worked back to Simmons, and Axel takes over there. With the touch pass, looking for center ground, that's the down, and Axel back over. Near side comes, this time it's a three, head off by McCullough in the neutral zone. Lindsey Vonn, far center, the touch pass comes, Harrigan finds a step through, lost on the touch check, and it's Axel back on. Saucers it ahead, hit the hit comes with Hildy through center, missed all the attempt, and becomes an ace instead on the thunder, with the call back down. By Shirley E. with 7:43 to play in period number three. There's a more and super touching on the 20. It's a McCutcheon's going to be chills. And now it's a little office. And if you set it off by McArthur, running around from center. He passed to Henry through center. Henry nudges the backside of the deep. Goes in the full check hole in the corner. Gets up from the cusser. Wound up the far side of the team is straight forward there. Jennison makes himself available on the near center. Burlington must start to look for its offense. They're down a pair here And as the third period kicks in, Ostrander all over Genesis, you see that with a Solarian. The pass McArthur at the point, and Cody Zavar chases after Larry Lopez. And the first turns it away from Aaron Marshall to Zavar. And that man pass comes to McArthur, bounces off the skates of Captain Henry along the right angle. That's reversed back the other way, and then this is crosses the angle, and another whistle for Ocean. And then as the third three, takes a slow down, and Ocean then starts to slow to 3-1-8. Now we'll have a ball to the right, and then the back of the center again. Looks like a full change here, and that is face up with the E's right, comes to the marker, he runs it back to Ellis at the fence. Now surrounding around the far side of Zillion Nets, and that settles it back to Nation. Nation, head on the shoulder, reverses back to Zillion Nets. Nation on the hurdle, moves on the pitch check, pushes him over, 4 seconds out against Nation on the corner. Nation digs it through, runs it around the other side, hanging on the tip, head off neatly by Val Hall to keep the pin down for a second. Big hit against Nation on the back wall, but that pushes him over. Allison Fox still playing with the puck, yields it back to Nathan. Butler still trying to solve it with 4 seconds of error. Cooley finally, Hay gets a tip to it. And she'll race after it against Allen Hall. Hay using her size and strength, powers toward the front. But on view of the back, Taylor is caught. This shot is ready. Trying to kind of might have made a sort of save. We've got a penalty here. And as Taylor sets us up, the call will come out for a minor against the Royal Cooley. And so Bradford, excellent opportunity here. We answer the shorts and thank you, Rudy Becciatore, who was headed through the penalty box. So Burlington without his top defenseman. And Brampton's Monty Dog will be the face of the world. They said somehow, Dupree, Heppert, up front, they'll stay together as they do at either strength. Because Engstrom and Ostrander will be fellows 4 and 5 on this final on 4. They said somehow, big swing, a kick save by Panini, and we're down, but Wilton Mandelbar is just shoveled all the way down. Edie around for a side, somehow. Right back to Engstrom behind that. Buckley getting a fight on the first half here by Shannon Berry. And it's Engstrom near center, fighting Heffer. Heffer through center. And as a little missing through the screen from the defenseman, kicked out by Flynn. Heffer gathers a long rebound, kicks it out top somehow. Stolen away. Can you hear it? Shorthanded breakaway. Harrigan racing it on E. Harrigan, Eastside. Hit the post, maybe E got a piece of it as well. We stay 3-1 and back the other way over Murray Dupree. Transition time is Kingston's own corner. Molly Kingston, first shot from distance, and he's going to knock the side by the back of Canelo. And the end action here with Keller in the box still for another minute, midway through the third period. After snapping out on the power play. Up front is McArthur, this time, with a couple of players in front, and missed everyone and went to the back wall. Now Lewis Gannett, Hickles together. Dupree now coming up there in the center, drops it back to Heffert, skips a pass for the side of Engstrom, teases it, blasted in front. Ariel wants it for the Heffert, jamming at it, and Spuddy with his penalty to get the save on the nick of time. Not a good save, it's only time to see Dupree, Ostrander, and Heffert all seemingly unmolested just outside the crease area. Canelli did it up and hold the fourth, and keep this a 3-1 hockey game. With a 9:28 to play in the third period. 39 seconds at the corner line. So Harrigan at the other end, looking for a piece of the puck. Maybe Edie, that big target, got a piece of the puck as well. McArthur back behind her own net. Thanks to Ian Sonny. Foiled for the moment. Now the thunder line is breaking. He's doing a nice job. First time, he's a steal. Can he hurt Sonny? He's trying to stuff on the moment. Edie, he's down on the line. Fox still over to this. Fox trying to create more havoc on the short hand. In the final 10 seconds of the penalty, he's actually killed. Finally, gathered by Julian. So she lays down ahead of Tiffany Hay. Hay then first step on the right wing side. Speaking on, out of the box comes Kelly. She races back to the free center. And it's dug 3-1-10. Now Julian is. Nice side step. Comes here back to Kelly. And then full stick down low to the corner. But 8.5 to play in the third period. Coming out of the zone, a long lead pass. And here's Kelly transition offensively. Kelly leading the charge down the right in the center, trying to pull through a couple of defenders. Edie promptly smothers it with a trapper to stall that rush with 8:24 to play.
in the third period, and the Thunder still nursing the 3-1 advantage. Face off the left for E. And he's just trying to fend off a couple of first tackles because he's slowly getting more aggressive with Dan Perry. And time wasted for the road team. Send it below. Center Harrow. Going to put it into space. Heffer was free. Almost tipped it through the defense by Ichabod. In concept, but Ichabod held the ground and went the other way. Kelly's alone. The ball hits the line 3-on-3. Rolls behind the cage, he's off the further step for Fett, trying to send him. Loose to flat side of the crease, bodies go down, gathered by Hooker, have a long ball on the sixth step as he tried to escape. Angstrom picks up on the far corner. Now the right line pass comes to Heffer, who kicks it outside. One on one, doesn't have much angle, and Heffer to move on as he goes behind it. Heffer to speed, goes to the same back of the leg. And now Heffer trying to go around and then come back on the far side, but the little kick it sealed. And we stay 3-1 with 7 minutes left in the third period. And this is all controlled by Tiffany Hay, getting in the circle. Pushy does not lose the count unless she's stuck in the jersey of Becky Jennison for getting a quick sample here. With 7:24 played in the third period, the USCHO game week, we're just in hand at the Conrad Center. We're going to the Canadian Women's Hockey League broadcast of Brampton, Canada's Center. And goals by Jada Heffer, Tiffany Hay, and Allison Fox, a 3-1 lead. All over the Burlington Barrel, including Burlington Tower, courtesy of former 28 star Amanda Lark. Our side pass from the region Sunday, runs to a federal equal statue in Christy Lenore. And it's final round back to the Hayes Center. Adelaide Norris comes to the final combat for the final. Jansen trying to fight for it with a barrel of fingers. Jansen gets a touch to get it back to center ice. Hayden reeling through the middle. Under the rest, years at the corner. As we get asked to backpedal over the line, as she touches up, the ball's going to be for a belated offside against the home team. With 6:53 to go in the third period. Both teams, the whole set of changes. McCutcheon out there to take the ball. Taylor Brampton opposite Lindsey Vaughn. And now it's Kelly starting the ball, gaining the center ice and shooting in. Cindy Eady, a little bit out of position as they're starting the front. Ball hard done, and McCarthy Henry spots it on his own. And if Kelly went to field, he's down the hall. Here's someone comes to Kelly. Kelly on the nice to end, trying to spin by, but bounced off his feet. Waits for the possession of McCutcheon, who turns it up right away. Gaining the stick of Henry, got it deep on the back end, no shoulder with a good chase. With 6:26 to play in the third period. Comes up the wall to Angstrom, wrist shot. Now Lance to save by Panella. And it's gathered down by Kelly Hall, is feeling the heat of the full check for Kathy Henry. Goes far side, here's Harrod and two out to it, but Harrod on the right left side. And then Harrod in front of Angle is spotted on the side by a slip of lead. Henry trying to find Angstrom down to the corner. Angstrom. Pressure on the forecheck comes from Harrod and Ankerbone. Angstrom trying to force his three guesses to O-Stanley. She's at the end of the shift. So short can in the deep. And then off on the chain with a final 50 to play. And a period at number three. That's another 3-1 lead. And that's it. Must look for the offense. Brampton went left. And just saw how Heffer was asleep on the walls of pressure. And it's taken over by Heffer. Heffer starts to get a nice game. Wrist shot. And goes right to the chest attack to left point. So she'll hold on for another draw here. And 5 minutes to go in the final frame. Heffer lines to his ankle. Found Kelly Zamora. Bounced up in the circle. And against center ground. Center ground wins out of the ground. It's a 3. Lays it back to the point. Good hold of the whip, but it's scored just on the blue line as McArthur couldn't quite keep it in. So they get the call. That's 4 on the sides there on the front. The clock has 5 to go in the third period. Center Howell wins the drive back to McArthur. McArthur shoots in. Behind
behind the net, and Elliott stuck it. So now there's Seattle rolling around the tip, couldn't feel by Sennheim at the point. Forcing out his low, Sennheim again holds the line. Finally, he stuck free from the neutral zone, 2-on-2 comes Kelly Zamora, which is probably dispossessed by Allison Funk back along the road. Zamora will try it again, uses it to the wall. Here comes Amanda Ball, trying to step on the eight, down to the front, goal line, and this play is saved by Cindy E. Keeps the 3-1 lead for the Brampton final. Larry Dupuy at Sennheim's consent to dump in a header upon the shooting. With 4:50 to go in period number 3. And Brampton for checking a 3-1 lead. Amanda Ball is active all night. Now they set from Christy Zamora, who leads on the poke check, to Tiffany Hay. Barr has the ball back, throwing to goal, and has had a couple of other great opportunities for Sennheim. Hay tips it off to Luke Felice. Here comes Kathleen Ponte, right wing side, catches by the end. Backhand pass to the third one, that one a little bit, she's trying to saucer. It goes high against the glass for the sun. And picks up there. Throws it down low to Kathleen Ponte. And this is staying against the back wall. And among the trees, the fifth from Hay. Hay, trying to throw it to the front, and it's denied, and it lets the game fall on top of it. With 4 seconds to play in the third period. So Brampton 3 and Burlington 1. The center play is right. Looks like that line's going to stay open. Time for a matchup on the front. Reaching in is Chrissy Zamora, going to take it away. And now Becky Keller, the right wing son, lost it deep. Engstrom, bumped hard by Zamora against the back glass. Engstrom holding on the ground, he's in a 5-9 frame hold advantage. Now Pump fighting out in space. Going to go to look wide ahead, tip top by Chris Stitch into the Burlington bench, and you get the stoppage. With 3:50 to go in the third step. Back with a 3-1 lead, Pump Hall has 33 saves. Cindy E with 22. At the other one. And Brampton continues to hold to its 2-goal advantage. Off the ball, Keller. Again, paired with Bowen Hall, goes up wide to Niagara Stone. And Kelly Holt, Holt feeding Lindsey Vonnie, and Vonnie gets it deep as Harrigan goes in to chase. He steps behind the cage, slung around the other side of Kathy Hanley, and was going to thread the percussion. He did find help in the form of Ocean, and she gets it deep. Kelly bends on his menu, wheels with the ball behind the cage, Burlington must look for his offensive chance and take a few risks. And as Hall does that, turning the play. Lindsey Vonnie, playmaking, trying to go back door. Hart was a step late in getting him. Worked up the wall, cleared to center ice. Pressure play by Ocean, settled out by Harrigan. Harrigan's been out there for a while, though. It's a little bit tired as she bumped in. Picked up the wall by stolen ball by Harrigan, so there's a bunch of stuff to make that play. And powers her way down low, trying to wrap it around, and Edie's got the near post sealed once again, and she'll cover up for a face off 2:50 on the third period play. Hope you're enjoying the inaugural video game. We're going to look at Shannon Heffley, who scored the game's first goal, so a couple of good opportunities to sign. And in line with Sam, Lee Dupuy, Lee Texas, along with both this league and it's best as an NWHO, the last team came in, just trying to find a shot for Amanda Ball instead of running. Heffley stopping for a final summer, gave it for the summer home. Dupuy was available at 7 the past week in Haven. With 2.5 to go here in the third period. That's stolen by Amanda Ball. Just struck past a low, it was a challenge of the run. That was Peter to move the target. Heffley settles down to Kevin. Puts it to the far corner. The low is trying to turn it back to the front, spins on his place. Kelly Zamora again floats it to right knee. That one went wide as well. Amanda Ball navigating into the corner, trying to sell. He was getting out. He was doing a nice job of keeping the crease area protected. He was half a counter attack. Heffley behind the sun trying to dangle the pass. The feed out front of the center. That was blocked off. And it's Heffley down low with the team changing behind him. Heffley sweeps it in front. Let's get saved by Pinella. Another two to go here in the 33. Let's we'll see when West Weiss can make time to get Tyler Valley off an extra speed. Can't do that, though, with a foot down in the whole zone. Out to the point, Angstrom, looking at our option, thinks through the shooting lanes, and pushes to the left wall, taking over by Hay. Hay now falls forward, heels out, and the pass was deflected, and it's tied up the line. But a minute and a half to go in the third period, and Madison's still holding to a 3-1 margin. Angstrom,
That's a 4 off the wall. It's scaled out still by the low end. As it goes the distance, though, still a nice pop on Burlington. This is going to be the best ball today. It was Tiffany Hay, kind of a similar style of play, sweeping on the right one side going the other way. And Tanya Penny seemingly making the actual save, the puck then escaping into the back of the net. And on goal number 3 was a powerful opportunity, a fairly out, flying to the left of distance. Again, Penny made an initial stop. The puck came to the final air, it went to the stick of Allison Fox, and Fox was able to cancel her. For Burlington, they are now starting to show away and set up Amanda Bowen in front, and then Bowen puts them home from point blank range. And that's what we said 3-1. Tommy Penny has made 33 saves. Cindy Eady has made 23 at the other end. And the drive has come. Body up by a cattle on the far side corner. And spins it free after the bounce of 40. That was the name. We go around near seven, taking back on 4-8. Zavara knocks it down for a moment, able to get it deep. Canelli's running away from the crease, away from it. There's a 5 seconds tick away here. Back in the federal group, and I guess it's all about their 30th of the season. They don't take it. And as Heppard, Haig, and Allison Fox give the host Thunder a 3-1 victory over the visiting Burlington Barracudas. Burlington goes for Amanda Barr, final shots on goal count, 36 for the Thunder, 24 for the Barracuda. We'll see the lineup of Simmons for the celebrating handshake after the game, and we can start to our CWA side covers. We're going to net pitches, but nothing too major here. And at the power 8 center, as Brampton takes home a 3-1 victory, and Tiffany Hayes, our good friend, former interviewee and game lead guest analyst on occasion, lines up with a game winning tackle, making good on her promise to us to give us something good to talk about. And as Brampton takes it back in the field, let's step aside for a quick commercial break. And Greg will be back to recap the score. And we're clearing out here at the Conway Center. And Brampton takes it back in the field. 3-1. We're off to the USCHO Game of the Week. We'll be back in just a moment.
It takes brains and brawn to be an elite female hockey player in Canada. These are the women of the new Canadian Women's Hockey League.
Welcome back to the Power Center. Brian Schultz, I'm here with Anthony for day 3-1. Brampton victory over. We're going to Barracudas again, recapping the score. Jenny Heppard on the first two down the right wing side, following off the rebound of her own initial attempt at simultaneous stuff, and she got the Thunder off and running by a count of 1-0. Burlington immediately equalized, courtesy of Michelle Warren and Amanda Warren, with only 7 down low, and Barr stuffing it home. A nice new shot. And we're excited a lot after away in the second period, though. Brampton got 2 down, as Tiffany Hayes threw down right wing side. And again, Penny looked like she made it just a save. The puck kind of got eluded there and trickled across the line. And Hayes had the goal. Brampton had the lead. It would not relinquish. They got some shots later in the period on the power play. And Allison Fox knocked down a pass out of there after a shot that came up to stick of 3 inches from long range. Penny made the shoulder save. The puck was high there. Fox had the composure to thread it down and then shoot home the lead down. They give Brampton the insurance it would need, and in the third period, a couple of good chances, most notably for Amanda Barr of the Barracudas, but not able to summon Cindy Eady, a Canadian Olympic softball star, and then goaltender with the Brampton Thunder, and Brampton takes it by a count on 3-2-1. Again, a reminder next week, we'll be right back here at the Power 8 Center.
as this summer chief, led by Canadian national teamers Jennifer Bonfell and Sandra Small and Sherry Piper, and made the Commonwealth Center take on their off rivals, the Brampton. That'll be next Saturday, 6 p.m. Eastern Time, and Sunday at 1 p.m. We're back in the college circuit in Hannah and Hanson, most of those Lakers, Dartmouth, Big Green. The Lakers coming to big play against number one race this weekend. Big Green actually off for first semester final games. So that should be a good one. It always is. Most of the Dartmouth next Sunday. That's at 1 p.m. Eastern. Both games available on USCHO.com. The rest of the Saturday game available through the CWHO website, www.cwhl.com. That's going to be solid for us. Couple people we have to thank for heading off the air. First and foremost, the front hand behind the camera tonight, Sean Miranda, making his debut with us here on the CWA show, or on the show. And thanks as always to Alan Broadcasting, Owen Doyle, Sean O'Connor, back in the studio, keeping things alive from start to finish. Thanks to our guests this week, Becky Teller and Vicky Sutterhart. Thanks to all the folks in the CWA show to help get this up and running. As we said, yeah, we're going to be hitching, we're going to be problems, I'm sure there are a few tonight, but it's a starting place, and it's hopefully a relationship that's going to grow and continue to be very fun to watch over this winter and many winters to come. This is Brian Schultz for the USCHO Game of the Week, wishing you all a very happy Saturday night, and we'll see you next week for a doubleheader. One more game on the CWHO on Saturday, and a game involving the most of the favorite of Big Green on Sunday. Have a great weekend. Stay safe and enjoy the holidays.